Cat tails 40 here, kitty. Here, kitty, kitty, I beckoned in the sweetest cat-calling voice I could muster. Like always, Max ran inside, grateful to get out of the pouring rain, but then promptly ran to another door to go back outside. "He's so dumb," laughed my husband, Jim. "He doesn't know how to stay out of the rain. We should have named him Stupid Cat instead of Max." Neither of us knew much about cats, and we couldn't understand people who acted like their cats were their children. We'd had three cats, but they certainly weren't like members of the family. Our children were excited over our first cat, the tiny orange ball of fur we kept only a month. He scratched the kids, and our son Clay was highly allergic to him. 20 years later, our second cat arrived one day. A pitiful-looking gray cat that wound itself around our legs while we sat on our deck. She looked hungry, so we fed her milk. We continued this, and, before long, she would walk to our refrigerator and meow, milk. Though we never took Kate to the vet or brushed or petted her much, Kate was content with food, water, and a warm place to sleep. She kept away mice and snakes. We had a great symbiotic relationship, but nothing more. Our third cat showed up a few years after Kate. I told Clay, "You can keep her, but she's your responsibility." I never paid enough attention to Allie to judge whether or not she was smart. When Clay joined the Marines, I decided one cat was quite enough and took Allie to the pound, assuming the shelter would find her a good home. My children and granddaughter, Amber, rode with me. The kids called me "cat killer" the whole way. "Can you say felinicide?" my son quipped. Amber mimicked "felinicide." That toddler is now 21, and I'm still not sure whether she's forgiven me for taking Allie to the pound. Kate kept at her mouser job for years before she began to lose weight. She never appeared to be in pain, but one day she vanished. I was shocked to find I missed her, but I never felt guilty about our lack of time with her. When a friend of our daughter, Melissa, had to move and find a home for her inside cat who loved to be outside, we were happy to adopt a new mouser. His old owner arrived with as much paraphernalia as a newborn baby, two crystal bowls, a litter box, litter, a small carrier, and health records. She also left his brushes, after demonstrating how he loved to be petted and groomed. She discussed his daily schedule and the special food he preferred. She left a generous supply, along with his favorite treats. Nervous as a new mom, I tried brushing and petting him, but I was afraid he'd bite. Max wandered around sniffing and exploring the house and didn't mess up anything. He used his litter box, ate, slept, and never seemed to miss his owner. We gradually introduced him to the outside, making sure he stayed nearby. Max would meander a while, then come right back inside to eat or use the litter box. We gradually increased his time outdoors and moved the litter box into the garage. That's when we first realized we'd adopted a stupid cat. We installed a kitty door in the garage. Max just looked at it, even when we tried coaxing him in with food. Jim also rigged up a small box equipped with a heat light, so Max wouldn't get too cold. Though he loved the garage, he refused to enter it except through our kitchen. "I don't want to be tied down," I complained. "I want to be able to leave for a few days without having someone cat sit." When grandchildren visited, I asked them to try to train Max to use his cat door. One grandchild stood inside the garage and poked food through the opening, letting Max sniff it, while the other child stayed outside and fairly pushed him through the kitty door. After hours, he finally learned how to get where food, water, a litter box, and warmth waited. Despite having mastered the cat door in the garage, Max continued to do the most awful things, like stalking birds and leaving them, dead, at our door. Once, when I opened the kitchen door, Max waltzed in with a live chipmunk in his mouth. I screamed, and he let go. We had an indoor chipmunk, alive, for days. "Stupid cat," I said. "What's wrong with him?" "He has food." When we'd leave for several days, he wouldn't touch his food or water, and we'd return to see a dead something at our kitchen door. "Max." I'd scream. "What's wrong with you? You're so stupid. You have food you won't eat, and you drink from the birdbath when you have clean water." So it went for years. Occasionally, we'd let Max inside when it was frigid, but basically he followed in Kate and Allie's footsteps, staying outside except during harsh weather. I brushed and petted him occasionally. Max seemed to prefer it that way. He also would meet our cars every afternoon, but when we'd say, "Hello, Max," the silly cat would wander away, head held high, like he didn't know who we were. Although he got in terrible fights, we never thought about taking him to a vet, not even for shots. We still felt he was just a mouser cat, a duty he did well. Then came the year when life, as I had known it, ended. I developed chronic illnesses and had surgery and complications that left me in terrible pain 24 hours a day. I was so weak I couldn't walk to the mailbox and felt like I'd become an old woman overnight. That first winter on disability was quiet and lonely. As I sat, miserably glued to my recliner, Max would come to the back door and meow. I'd let him in, he'd wander around and then settle down at my feet, totally content. As I spent more time with him, I noticed he seemed to move slower in the morning. "Do your joints hurt, Maxie?" I asked one day. Jim was amused at my new interest in Max, but he did research on cat years. "He's older than we are," Jim said. I was shocked and recognized Max was often hurting too. I spent more time with him, brushing him daily. "Good therapy," I said, a bit embarrassed. Before long, Max, who was becoming quite smart, would quietly curl up beside me, purring softly, as I slept. He never clawed the furniture, jumped on anything other than my lap, or had an accident. Soon, a food and water bowl also appeared in our kitchen. Max told us when he wanted out, which was fairly often, and it was sort of lonesome without him. One day, as I talked to him, he put his paws on my chest, looked me in the eyes, and twisted his neck as if to say, "Stroke my head." He butted it against my head and continued this until he taught me to stroke him under his chin and to butt my head against his. Max was more sensitive to my moods and pains than many of my family and friends. When I felt most forlorn, he would quietly curl up beside me, his purring seemingly synchronized to my beating heart. "This is one amazing cat," I thought. One night my husband and I went to Starbucks at Barnes & Noble. While we sipped coffee we browsed several books, including one about cats. We bought it to continue reading at home. Suddenly, a lot of things Max had tried to tell us made sense. The more we read, the more we understood our sweet, and oh so smart, cat. Soon I discovered he was petrified of storms. Just like me, I empathized. As I listened and watched him, more understanding took place. His different meows each meant something. I'd praise him, "Maxie, what a smart boy you are." He still loved being outside, but one day I noticed him limping and saw white fur near the door. Max had a scratch over one eye. "Oh no, he got into another fight," I told Jim. My husband assured me that Max would be okay, but he wasn't. He stayed inside and began hiding under our bed. We moved his food and water nearby, but he wouldn't eat. After a few days, Max allowed his ignorant parents to hold him. I gasped. His right front paw was swollen 4 times its normal size. "How could we have been so stupid?" I wailed. Panicked, I called my daughter, who has 3 large dogs. Her roommate has 4 cats. They both always have huge vet bills. I'd always thought doctors are for people, but now I realized they are for pets, too. I had no idea whom to call or how I'd get Max into the crate he'd outgrown. Most of all, I was terribly ashamed he'd had no shots in 10 years. "You've got to get him to our vet immediately," Melissa said. "I have to work, but Kat can come take you." Swallowing my pride, I let her appropriately named roommate get Max into the large crate she brought. I was fearful of a huge bill we couldn't afford, since my medical bills were still enormous. There was no money for emergencies like this, but I didn't care. I just wanted Maxie to live, and I prayed to have another chance to show him how much I loved him. "The infection is really advanced. I'm not sure we can S-avenue him," the vet said. After 2 days, Max did come home. My daughter's friend came every day to give him his medications. She knew exactly how to get him to open his mouth. We were amazed. When Jim and I took over giving his meds, it took both of us to get a few drops in his mouth. The saddest thing was how passive our independent Max had become. Though weak, he preferred going outside to using his litter box. When he wanted out, he'd look at the door, and Jim would gently pick him up and place him a few feet into the yard. Max wouldn't move from that spot. He'd feebly try to bury his waist and then patiently wait to be picked back up. In 2 weeks, Max had enough energy to stay outside for a few minutes, and a week after that, he decided he's been inside quite long enough, thank you. We were like two nervous, overprotective parents sending their only child off to school the first day. What if that black cat bothers him again? We fretted. These days, I think we need Max more than he needs us. We have the mouser cat we trained, so Max only wants in when it's really hot or cold or during a storm. He wants to be petted when he's good and ready, and he loves being brushed, but most of the time the great outdoors, rather than with us, is where he prefers to be. Max, our brilliant cat, struts down his sidewalk like the king of the world. He looks at us rather smugly. I can almost hear him meow to the next door cat. Thank goodness, I finally got my humans trained. They were so stupid I thought they'd never catch on. Now maybe I can enjoy my retirement days with a little peace.